Hey folks, David Frost, my strategic forecast. You're here for another episode of Common Sense Market Analysis. Today is Friday, March 2, 2018. We're looking at a daily chart of the SPY or Spider, which is the proxy for the S&P 500. And we had another interesting day out in the markets today. We had a slight gap down this morning, and then by the end of the trading session, there was a recovery, and we finished near the highs of the day. Not that this is a reversal candle, but that's a signal of a at least short-term bottom in the market. Now, bottom meaning doesn't have to be that we're going to new all-time highs and keep going. That could possibly be the case. It's just not the probable case. However, you can also see what's developing, and we talk about this almost each and every night because this pattern tends to show up on charts over and over and over again. And what we have working here is an A leg from the bottom made in February, early February, a B leg down to this morning, for example, and this is the possibility, and then a C leg on its way in the making as we speak now. If it does finish, it will have to finish, technically speaking, above the high of the A leg. That's from the big picture perspective on the daily chart. There is a possibility of a zigzag or ABC pattern in development. What's also interesting to note, and we talked about this a little bit last night as well, which is that a lot of traders, a lot of investors, a lot of anybody, retail traders, amateur traders out there, they get sucked into the short side on a day like yesterday, thinking that the market is breaking down, and they hear the media, and all of a sudden, a lot of people end up putting their bear hats on, and they start talking about a retest of the lows, and people and traders have a tendency to jump on board thinking that they're going to catch a falling knife on the way down, and that's just precisely at the wrong time. Generally speaking, when everybody shifts to one side of the boat generally starts to tip over and dumps them in the water. And we'll see if that's the case leading into next week. If we get follow through to the upside, that will have been the case. Retail traders, amateur traders are generally wrong the majority of the time. You'll generally see them buying into the market up here, selling the market down here, selling the market down here, and they typically continuously over and over again do the wrong thing at precisely the wrong time. We'll see if that was the case, but I know that there were a lot of puts bought late this week. There was a shift in sentiment to the bearish side. That's generally the sign of at least a short-term bottom, not necessarily a continuation pattern. We also talked about the fact that last night on Thursday evening was a full moon, and that does at times have a tendency to have a trend change in the markets. And it's not just the stock market. It can have a trend change in a precious metals markets, in other markets across the board. And that seemed to be taking hold today. We'll see if that remains the case into next week and whether or not we do get some follow through. In addition, just to reiterate, we had what's called a 50% retracement. So there's your 50% mark that comes in at 265.92. The 50% represents this pivot low to this pivot high. And as of yesterday, we retraced 50% of that move, also coming into the 100 period moving average. We did have the full moon. We also have a lot of chart consolidation in this area here, and that's the chart's way of telling us that that price level in and around this area is important. And what's important about it, and what I like to note, is that this price was important where I have the circle over here. This is called chart vibration, and that price level was important long before the 50% retracement became an issue or became prevalent, because the 50% retracement that we hit yesterday didn't exist until we put in a pivot low, a pivot high. And it is ironic how the 50% retracement came right in that same zone as this former area where the chart was telling us this is a consolidation area that we had a breakout from, and that's the chart's way of telling us that that price level is important. This was a short-term pivot high. We pulled back a little bit. rallied up, consolidated, and then broke out to the upside. And that's the chart's way of telling us that in and around this area, not pinpointing to the penny, this general zone is important to the chart. And it was once again important at the 50% retracement mark of an area that didn't exist on the original consolidation back over here. I find that fascinating. It's interesting information nonetheless. The one takeaway that I like to emphasize is the charts are always trying to tell us where the important price levels are, and it's our job to try and figure out what the chart is trying to tell us. On the upside, the next major area of resistance that this market's going to have to get through comes in right around this red candle high, which also coincides with the 50 period moving average coming in at 273.08. We'll call it just above 273. If we should get up there at some point into next week, early next week, mid next week, whenever it is, if it happens, that area should provide at least at a minimum an area of intraday resistance to the market. It's about 4 points away or 40 S&P points away. So maybe we have to worry about it on Monday. Maybe we don't. But at some point in time, I suspect the market will want to get up to that area as long as we can have follow through upside into next week. Now on the downside, you know, we want to talk about both sides of the market. So on the downside, the important level is going to be really where either today's low comes in, and this is really almost the same area, or this green candle low, and any close on a daily chart, so a daily close below this level is going to be negative for the market, and that's really going to add, there's a lot of white space in here, and that's going to bring in double bottom into play, double bottom being the lows from early February. We also had a canary in the coal mine today. We had a canary yesterday and we had a canary the day before. You know, my favorite market leading indicator is the IWM. While we did close the month of February below the upsloping trend line, that's from the long-term monthly chart, we're now below that line, now fighting back to get above that line. We'll see what happens. It's a monthly chart close. We closed below it in February. If we recapture it in March, so be it. But right now, it can be the makings of a failed breakdown. Failed breakout, meaning we close back below the line. That would be a failed breakout move. But over the last couple of sessions, we talked about the fact that on an intraday basis, the IWM was showing relative strength to the S&P 500. While the S&P was down, the IWM was down less. While the S&P might have been breaking down, the IWM wasn't necessarily leading the markets on the downside. We saw that exact scenario today. Here's an intraday 10-minute chart of the IWM. Point a couple of things out that are very, very interesting. When you look at the IWM, you can see where we made a bottom early in the day, the same place we made a bottom on the spider. We had a gap down, okay, and we made a bottom. Now, the IWM began creeping up immediately, okay? So there was no hesitation. The IWM began recovery on an immediate basis. Now, if we just picture that and leave that in our mind for a second, let's go back to the spider chart, and you'll see what happened. The spider did not, and this is the S&P 500, did not immediately recover. While we tried to recover, we kind of chopped around in this lower end of the day's range or the morning's range for a while, and we did not have an immediate recovery. While we did have one later in the session, we didn't have one as fast and as robust as the IWM did. When the IWM was recovering fast and hard, that was a telltale sign that the markets were not going to break down. A lot of times, a market reversal is made, whether it's on the upside or the downside. If we get a gap higher in the morning and finish on the lows, that's good for a market reversal, telling us that likely story is over the, at least the short term, the market's put in a top and it's going to go down. It's going to have downward pressure in the immediate term. Well, what happened today was the flip side of that. We gapped lower and reversed intraday, finishing near the highs. That's generally a sign of reversal from a low point meaning going upward, at least for the short term. The IWM was telling us that early in the session. It gave us some hints and clues over the last couple of days, and then today, early in the day, it was crystal clear that the IWM had extreme relative strength. We finished up 1.6% in the Russell 2000 Index. We finished up 0.6% in the S&P 500 Index, or the SPDR. The S&P Cash Index finished up 0.5%. Interestingly enough, the NASDAQ Composite finished up over 1%. And what that tells us is, look at those two indexes. The NASDAQ and the IWM are really where your risk money goes to play. Okay, they're risk assets in relation to the S&P 500 and the Dow Jones Industrial Average, for example. The risk targeted money is going into the indexes such as, and the stocks such as found in the IWM or Russell 2000 Index and the NASDAQ, your tech heavy index. And again, the market is always trying to tell us something. It's our job to interpret what it's trying to tell. And this is my way of conveying to you how I interpret the markets. And just as a side note, I want to make mention of something. So I have a lot of traders, obviously, that have taken my course at LazyEminiTrader.com. And in the course, I teach how to read charts, not just the E-mini contract, but it applies to all charts, all vehicles, whether it's a stock, a commodity, the S&P 500, it doesn't make any difference. All charts act and react the same way. But the point is that intraday, I'll get emails on a pretty frequent basis, especially on a day like today, where I have traders that have taken the course and they tell me, here's what I see. Can you confirm that I'm looking at this correctly? I see the IWM doing this. I see this chart pattern on the SPDR or the S&P E-mini futures contract, which is one and the same. The charts generally look the same. So they'll email me with their ideas of what they're looking at. They want to confirm their findings. They want to confirm that they see a bullish pattern in place. They want to confirm they see a bearish pattern in place. They want to confirm certain things that are taught in the course, and I'm happy to correspond with them back and forth to either confirm what they're saying or give them my idea on what I see and kind of circle them back to the course and say, you might want to take a look at this one more time. The point is all about interpretation. Everything is here on the charts. The question is, the trader, analyst, investor, the person reading the chart, are they able to interpret and decipher what the charts are trying to tell us? And that was my goal in creating the Lazy E-Mini Trader course. My goal was to teach traders, anyone that wants to learn and that has the desire and the discipline to learn, to teach them how to read and interpret the markets and at least be able to gain a confidence level in investing and trading in this market. Because when you learn how to read the charts, you really take a lot of the guesswork away from what's going on, and there's two reasons why. Number one is, we know where we're wrong. We know when we're interpreting a chart and a chart pattern, we know where that pattern may be failing. That allows us to lose on trades if we have to lose, small and fast. But the other thing is, we're able to identify patterns that play out on the charts over and over and over again. A lot of them I point out here each and every night. And it's not an accident, it's not a coincidence. I'm trying to get the point across that anybody can do this if they put in the time and the effort. Enough with the commercial and the side story. Now on to the transports. And the transports were interesting today because there was a divergence early in the day between the SPDR or the S&P 500, the IWM, and the transports. So the transports actually gapped lower, and instead of recovering, or like the S&P 500, just going sideways in the lower portion of the trading range from the morning session, it actually went lower before recovering, finishing near the high of the day. So while the transports finished flat for the day and the other indexes were up, we did have a recovery, but there was an intraday divergence. I'm not sure yet how meaningful that is or will be into next week, but I thought it was important just to point it out nonetheless. I think it has to be taken as a positive, even though they went lower while the other indexes, meaning the transports went lower when the other indexes were rallying in the morning, or at least beginning to rally. What was interesting was the type of recovery we had, because the transports were breaking down early this morning. And there was one side of me that said, are the transports going to take down the rest of the market? And it actually worked in reverse, and the market pulled up the transports. And I think it was a pretty bullish sign for the transports to finish flat for the day based on where they were from the morning session. At the lows today, the transports were down about 185 points or so from yesterday's close. So they were taking a pretty good thumping. For them to rally back 185, almost 190 points from the lows today, I have to take that as a sign of bullish behavior. We'll do a quick check-in at the broker-dealer index. This is the financial sector, or at least in part the financial sector. And a couple of things we want to note. The financials have somewhat of the same story as the transports that we just talked about. They were getting hit pretty hard at the open today and in the morning session, and you'll see what happened. We came into the pierce through, we hit yesterday the 20 period moving average, pierced through that today, and then hit the 50 period moving average, reversed off that, finishing near the highs of the day. Just as a recap, remember from the other day, we put in a tail candle, said it's generally a sign of a at least short-term trend change. What happened? It was a short-term trend change, and this morning we hit a low, had an intraday reversal, and we'll see if this is just a trading range or if we're going to actually make new highs in the financial sector. Remember, the market is unlikely to break down without a breakdown occurring in the financial sector. Likewise, the market is unlikely to rally substantially without participation from the financial sector. And that's part and parcel why I watch the financial sector so closely. The financial sector is obviously an integral part of not only the U.S. market, but the global markets. Another proxy I like to look at each and every day, I don't necessarily discuss it in this video each and every day, but certainly the Philadelphia Semiconductor Index has always been somewhat of a stalwart in terms of a leading market indicator. And the reason I'm pointing it out today is because you can see the daily chart, the candle from today is a reversal candle. The Philadelphia Semiconductor Index was up 1.76% today. That's a tremendous day. And by the way, here's a 10-minute chart. You can see we had a gap down and we had a perpetually up day ever since. And when you see something like that, that's the market's way of telling you that we just had a reversal. Now, again, nothing is 100% of the time. Could we go down on Monday? Of course we can. Anything is possible. But this is the market's way of telling us that it was bullish behavior today and we're likely to see follow through into next week. There were buyers in the market today. And by the way, speaking of buyers in the market, we gauge the volume in the market by the spiders, and while it wasn't a tremendous up day in terms of volume, we did have about 138 million shares traded, 139 million shares in the spiders, so it was slightly above average. We had more volume yesterday on the down day. I would have liked to see us peak above yesterday's volume in today's up day, and that would tell me more in terms of the potential follow through into next week. But all in all, for a Friday afternoon, it wasn't that bad. Well above average. Average is about 115, 16 million shares. So above average, and for a Friday, not a bad showing in terms of volume. We're just looking for more on Monday. Let's see what the market wants to tell us leading into next week. Now we'll go over to the gold market, and it was a nice big up day in gold. And I want to go back to, and I hate to do this because I know some people kind of tilt their head and give it the lassie look of what's he talking about in terms of a full moon and what does that have to do with the markets. But time and time again, and I talk about it each and every time it happens, just about, doesn't have an impact, full moon that is, doesn't have an impact every single time on all the markets, but it does have an impact on a lot of the markets a lot of the time. So I have to pay attention to it. I have to take it seriously because I've been watching this for years and years and years, and you can see what happened today. We were down, we were trading down in the gold market pretty substantially from the recent highs. We came into the 100 period moving average. We talked about the market symmetry that was developing and that, you know, the look of the chart in gold. So we had a down move, sideways, that's a bearish pattern. We talk about that all the time. Another down move, a little shimmy for a day or so on the side, and then another down move. All these down moves, they're not equal, but they're somewhat equidistant to each other, and that is market symmetry at its finest, at least from a visual perspective. But today, we had a big rally in gold, up $18.50, 1.4%. Does it have to do with the full moon? I don't know. It's just interesting to talk about it, watch it unfold after the fact. It happens not every time, but a lot of the time. We traded up into the 50-period moving average. There's a lot of work to be done in gold if we're going to resume the rally to the upside. First order of business is the big hurdle is going to be right around 1338, give or take. Let me get the exact number off the chart for what that is. 1338 was always an important number. You'll remember that number. It was on the charts for a while. 1338 spot 40 is this important number up here. That's the high of this red candle. If we can get by chance above that level and begin closing daily and trading above that level, that's going to be a positive sign for gold. That's going to be a line in the sand. That's going to be a marker. So we'll see what happens if and when gold can rally up into that line right there at 1338 and change. We'll see how it handles. We'll see how gold handles that price level. Do we get rejected from that price level, or do we bust through that price level? It will be very interesting to see one way or the other. We don't have a position recommended in gold right now. It was in the middle of a range. There was no clear picture on direction. And when we don't have a clear picture that the chart is telling us that it has a high probability of doing this thing, then we just do nothing. I'm just analyzing it, giving you my thoughts, telling you what I see on the charts. But there was no clear picture on which direction gold was going until it broke down and closed below this level here, which was 1319 spot 10. That was a sign that gold was out of the bullish pattern and going to break down, but there's too much going on down here. You have a 100 period moving average, 200 period moving average, you had a full moon coming up. So we don't want to sell, what's called in the hole. After something is down substantially, it's very difficult to sell short a market that's already been down. That's what happened in the spider yesterday. Traders were selling in the hole, and they ended up selling and got one in the face today on the market reversal. It happens over and over and over again. You want to avoid selling in the hole. You want to sell into major resistance points, and you want to buy into major support areas. That's opposite of what most retail and amateur investors do. Be on the same side as the institutional investors and traders. That's the foundation of what I teach in my course at LazyEMiniTrader.com. Crude oil, not much doing. We were up a little bit in crude oil today, up 46 cents, 0.75%. But we're going to have to get above these moving averages, the 20 and the 50 period moving average, for us to resume the upside in the crude oil market. I don't think the rally is over yet. I think this is still technically in a longer term uptrend that's not over. I still think we have a shot at all the way up into the 70-ish range. 73 and change is my ultimate target. It's not something that's likely to happen overnight, but it is something that I feel can happen if we can get above at least first order of business is these moving averages. And then what we have to do is get above this recent high that was rejected at 64. If we can get above 64, then we're going to be on our way. We'll take it one day at a time. And with that, folks, it's everything I wanted to and intended to discuss tonight. So I'm going to give it a wrap here. I'm David Frost, My Strategic Forecast. Thanks for tuning in for another episode of Common Sense Market Analysis.